Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, today we'll be looking at Galatians chapter 4. And in this chapter, Apostle Paul tells us something about the law of Moses, and then he still wants to convince us and teach us that we no longer need the law of Moses, that the law of Moses was used for some time in the past, but now when we have Jesus, we no longer need that law. Okay? So chapter 4, verse 1, Apostle Paul starts, "I mean that the heir, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything, but he is under guardians and managers until the date set by his father." And here Apostle Paul says that, yeah, we Jewish people, he's talking about the Jewish people, we were like little children and we were like slaves and we needed a guardian. And that guardian was the law of Moses. But that law of Moses was necessary till a certain date. And that date was when Jesus came. Now, when Jesus comes, you no longer need the law of Moses. What you need is Jesus. So now you can, through your faith in Jesus, be adopted by God, and you no longer need the law of Moses. So he continues, verse 3. "In the same way, we also, when we were children," he means like the people of Israel, "when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son." So Jesus came, Jesus was incarnate, "born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law," to redeem Jews, Jewish people, "so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, 'Abba, Father.' So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God." Okay? So again, Apostle Paul, he emphasizes the fact that, yeah, we had the law of Moses, but till a certain point. And when Jesus came, we no longer need the law of Moses. Now we are sons of God through Jesus. We are adopted by God through Jesus. And then from verse 8 to verse 20, Apostle Paul expresses his concern for the Galatians. So here, Apostle Paul, and you need to remember that Galatians are Gentiles. They are not Jews. Galatians, like, now you can see a parallel here, that Jewish people, they were slaves of the law of Moses, Mosaic law. But Galatians, they didn't have any law. They didn't have this law of Moses. But what did they have? They had all their false beliefs. So they worshiped false gods. They also were slaves, but they were slaves of something else. Now, Apostle Paul, he talked a little bit about the slavery of the law. Now he's talking about when people are slaves to demons. In this particular case, Galatians, who are Gentiles. Verse 8, "Formerly, when you did not know God," he means the true God, "you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods," demons. "But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world, whose slaves you want to be once more? You observe days and months and seasons and years. I'm afraid I may have labored over you in vain." Again, so Paul says, now in Jesus Christ, you are free from all kind of slavery and worshiping anything else except Jesus. Why do you need to put Jesus aside and go back and worship or observe those principles and holidays and days and religious traditions that have nothing to do with Jesus. Yeah, you did that in the past, but now when you have Jesus, you need to focus completely on Jesus Christ. Otherwise, Paul says, I am afraid I may have labored over you in vain. Verse 12, brothers, I entreat you, become as I am, for I also have become as you are. He says, well, I'm a Jew, I became like you Gentiles. Now you Gentiles learn to be free from me, be like me. I'm free in Jesus, Apostle Paul says. Now be free in Jesus like I am. You did me no wrong. Verse 13, you know it was because of a bodily ailment that I preached the gospel to you at first. And though my condition was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. So Apostle Paul just reminds Galatians here that he had a certain illness, he had a certain problem. That is why he was staying in this area, in the region of Galatia, and that is why he had an opportunity to preach to Galatians. Now, can you imagine that Apostle Paul is sick? He has a problem, and when somebody is sick and preaching the gospel, you would just look at them and think, okay, so you're just preaching something new, but you are sick, you have a problem. So it may be difficult to listen to such people who have problems. But now Galatians, we can see that Galatians, verse 14, and though my condition was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. So Paul praises Galatians here. Verse 15, what then has become of your blessedness? For I testify to you that, if possible, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me. You see how Galatians loved Apostle Paul. Verse 16, have I then become your enemy by telling you the truth? And you see, this is the problem we can see nowadays in churches, that sometimes when pastors, ministers of the word, when they tell the truth, people kind of think, oh, you're now my enemy because you're telling me the truth. And we can see that Apostle Paul was in the same situation. He's telling the truth, and they may not like it. So that is why he says, have I then become your enemy by telling you the truth? You loved me so much. You received me so well. Now I'm telling you the truth. Have I then become your enemy? And then verse 17. They, and by they he means false teachers, they make much of you, but for no good purpose. They want to shut you out that you may make much of them. So basically he says, yeah, these false teachers, they are nice to you, they want to win you over, they want to disconnect me from you or you from me. And it's okay when you want to teach somebody with zeal, but it depends on the purpose. So they want to shut you out that you may make much of them. And then verse 18, it is always good to be made much of for a good purpose. It is good when you try to win somebody over for the truth. And not only when I'm present with you, my little children for whom I am again in the anguish of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. I wish I could be present with you now and change my tone, for I'm perplexed about you. You can see that Galatians, they heard the true gospel, but then new teachers appear, and then these Galatians, they start listening to those false teachers. And Apostle Paul is not happy. He's really concerned. He's concerned for their salvation. You see verse 19, my little children for whom I am again in the anguish of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. You see, when a pastor, an apostle, an evangelist preaches the word of God, so the end result, the end goal is we want to see Christ formed in us. We can see that we are like Jesus Christ, that we allow Jesus to be in us, we listen to the word of Jesus. So with Galatians, the situation was dangerous. You know, this situation was dangerous because when you look at them, they have this false teaching, and no longer you could see Christ in them. And Apostle Paul wants to see that, he wants to see Christ formed in Galatians. We need to be super attentive to the Word of God, and we should want Christ to be formed in us, right? We should follow closely the Word of Jesus Christ. This is how we become more and more like Jesus. Now, Apostle Paul also gives an example of Hagar and Sarah. And Hagar and Sarah are two wives of Abraham. And we already know that Apostle Paul spoke about Abraham and that we should be like Abraham, connected to God through our faith. Now he talks about Sarah and Hagar. So if you remember Abraham, he has been given a promise by God that he will have a son. But he wouldn't have a son for some time. And Sarah, so she heard the promise, but she didn't quite believe it. So she decided to orchestrate a son for her husband. And she asked her slave, Hagar, to become Abraham's wife, so that when she has a child, so the child may become Abraham's son and heir. So, but at the same time, God still gave this, you know, promise to Sarah and Abraham that they too will have a son. So at the end of the day, we see that Hagar has a child, his name is Ishmael. And then Sarah eventually has, you know, her promised child, and his name is Isaac. So now, what happens next? Ishmael, he persecutes Isaac. He mocks him. He makes fun of him. He is not nice to him. So, and Apostle Paul, he says, well, you know what? We are just, you know, Christians and Jews. We are like Sarah and Hagar. We are like Isaac and Ishmael. Let us look at the text. Verse 21, tell me, you who desire to be under the law, do you not listen to the law? Again, so he addresses to those Galatians who all of a sudden want to follow and observe the Jewish law and traditions. Verse 22, for it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a slave woman, it's Hagar, and one by a free woman, it's Sarah. But the son of the slave was born according to the flesh, while the son of the free woman was born through promise. Now, this may be interpreted allegorically. So, Apostle Paul interprets it allegorically. These women, he says, are two covenants. One is from Mount Sinai, so, and this is the covenant of Moses, bearing children for slavery. She is Hagar. So basically, Apostle Paul says that Hagar, the slave woman, so she bears children for slavery, and this is basically the law of Moses, the Mosaic law, which bears children for slavery as well. Verse 25, now Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia. She corresponds to the present Jerusalem, because present Jerusalem in the times of Apostle Paul would follow the law of Moses, right? For she is in slavery with her children. She is in slavery to the law of Moses. So she's subject to the law of Moses. That is why the Jewish people, they are like Hagar. They are slaves of the Mosaic law. Verse 26. But the Jerusalem above, now he is talking about the church, about everybody who believes in Jesus, yeah? But the Jerusalem above, like spiritual Jerusalem, is free, and she, this free spiritual Jerusalem, is our mother. For it is written, rejoice, O barren one who does not bear. Break forth and cry aloud, you who are not in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than those of the one who has a husband. Well, barren one who doesn't bear, this is Sarah. But then miracle happened, and she had a child. And in the same way, Apostle Paul says, well, people from all the nations, we didn't have any chance to be with God, to be saved by God, but then a miracle happened, and then because of Jesus, we are now justified, right? This is what he wants to say. And then verse 28, now you brothers, like Isaac, are children of promise. And Isaac, if you remember, it's Sarah's son, and she was old, and she was not supposed to have children. And then all of a sudden, she has a son, and his name is Isaac, and he is the son of promise, and he is also the heir to Abraham, right? So all of a sudden, Isaac has all the blessings. And the Apostle Paul says that we, in the same way, we are the sort of miraculously born, spiritually born children of God, children of promise, and we have all the spiritual blessings. We are heirs and children of God, like Isaac. So it's a miracle. Verse 29, but just as at that time he who was born according to the flesh persecuted him who was born according to the spirit, so also it is now. Born according to the flesh is Ishmael, the son of Hagar. And born according to the spirit is Isaac, born of Sarah, right? So now Ishmael, we know from the Bible, he was older than Isaac, and he would mock and mistreat Isaac. So in the same way, Apostle Paul says, Jews are mistreating Christians. So verse 30, but what does the scripture say? Cast out the slave woman and her son, for the son of the slave woman shall not inherit with the son of the free woman. So, brothers, we are not children of the slave, but of the free woman. So, basically, Apostle Paul says, well, whoever follows the Mosaic law, the law of Moses, is a slave and doesn't inherit anything. Whoever follows Jesus is free and inherits everything. So this is basically what Apostle Paul is talking about in chapter 4. So he still continues to explain to Galatians that they are children of promise, that through their faith in Jesus, they are adopted by God, they are children of God, and that they do not need to follow and observe Jewish religious traditions and practices.